only thing I got is that I enjoy doing this. I enjoy it very much. I believe in Gregg County. My family came here, and they came here in 1968, and I came here in 1971. And, this community's been absolutely godsend for myself and our family. And we should give much back. But as much given, much as called upon to give. And I enjoy doing that. I will start out by telling you that the state of the county is strong. I've said that now, I think, every time I've talked to you about it, but I had to call John last night because I had to remember when was the last time I talked to him. My life about 2 years ago, and it's certainly turned everything upside down. A lot of things I'm going to talk about today you can put your hand on and you can see them, you can see it, you can feel it. But all those things that I'm going to talk about in a few minutes are done with the people that live here in this community. And I keep saying that, and I'll continue to say it. This is a great community with a lot of great people in it. I've never had once when I've reached out, asked someone to help or to serve on the board or to make a difference. If they have not done so, they've done so with dignity and full charge. In fact, I was hoping Linda Thomas was here today. I appointed her in the RMA, RMA board, Northeast Texas Regional Mobility Authority, back in 2004. The governor appointed her chairman, I think in 2005 or 6, and she just retired from that board. And the things they've gotten done at the Net RMA are phenomenal. This community alone, with the help of the city and the county and Net RMA, have done a number of projects with grants that were given to the city and the county from the Net RMA. And Linda Thomas had a lot to do with that. Almost $1 million to date of the projects they've involved themselves with here. And so, if you see Linda, thank her for her service. She was thanked last week in Smith County at a banquet. And she was given the highest honor you can be given at a Texas Department of Transportation award, is the Roadhand Award, which is someone that is service above self, quoting Rotary, that has done tremendous work for the connectivity of this community and regional. And so you see her, thank you for that. Again, I had to ask John when was the last time we talked, because I know we talked about COVID so much, and you all gave the award, Citizen Award. But I guess I start out this speech the same way I started it the last time I talked to you. Let's talk about COVID for just a little bit. I'm not going to rehash all the things that were done, what the community's done. You all are familiar with that. But I think one thing that's becoming very clear about COVID, and I was talking about this earlier. If you have your vaccination, you certainly could get it again, but you're not going to be as critically ill. So if you haven't gotten your vaccination, let me encourage you to do so. The facts are in around the hospitals and the public here. If you have your vaccination and you had your booster, the chances of you having critically ill are very slim. And I'm not a doctor, I'm not proposing that. I'm just telling you what the facts and the figures are sharing with me that I need to either meet weekly or monthly with the emergency operation managers and or hospital people telling me about this and helping us plan for the next challenge that the COVID might give us. But I will tell you that in my opinion, and only my opinion, COVID's here. It's going to be here for a long, long, long time. And if you haven't got your vaccination, please get it. If you want to wear a mask, wear it. It certainly helps. But in the end of the day, COVID's going to be here. One of the things I'm proudest about in that COVID is that right now we're a little over 80,000 people that have been vaccinated. When we closed that hub, we were right at around 65,000 to 70,000. And vaccine became available everywhere, and people started getting vaccinated. And I'm very proud of what we did as a community, because that it just couldn't have happened without Chris's good shepherd and the medical expertise that they brought to that party. And the city and the EMS and all those folks that you all have honored. But I will never miss a chance to praise them, because without them it couldn't have happened. And that's obviously that. And I'm trying to rush through a lot of this because I'd really like to take questions on anything you might want to talk about. You probably saw in the newspaper, Jolie covered this pretty well, pretty good. So thank you, Jolie, for real good. We just gave $1 million to Good Shepherd. I mean, we've got $1 million set up for regional from Christus's standpoint, to encourage nurses to stay and or sign bonuses. Both those hospitals got devastated during COVID with the nurses and or doctors. Some just decided to get out of practice. And so we thought it was the right thing to do from the court's perspective, that we both allocate $1 million to each hospital, because without them, I don't know where we would be. And that is a fact. That is just facts. That without them, this community would be a whole lot worse off than it is today. So thank you, Good Shepherd, Christus, and thank you, Warren Region. Let's talk a little bit about Road and Bridge. Even though COVID was going on, and we've got commissioners like Ronnie McKinney, we don't stop. He's barrel right on through it, keep on working. And that's what he did in his road crews. We had several important road projects that were completed in his precincts, as well as some other precincts. And they included safety enhancements. The county was a partner with the city on regarding funds that we received from that RMA for safety enhancements, George Ritchie McCann Road, and Hawkins Parkway and Shepherd Way. And these are all, again, partnerships with the City of Longview and the Northeast Texas Regional Mobility Authority. Speaking of Commissioner McKinney, we had a bridge replacement at Big Woods Road at Richard Creek, located Precinct 1, which was a fairly large project if you're familiar with that part of Gregg County. We assisted the cities of White Oak, Clarksville City, Lakeport, and Easton with road and right-of-way maintenance. We assisted Kilgore College in Precinct 3 with 5 public parking facilities. We did the work and they paid for the asphalt. I mentioned these things to you in the past, and they were in the plans, or they were in the process of being canceled or being delayed, but I'm going to mention them again because we're back on track and they're starting to move forward. I met with TxDOT last week when I was over in Smith County and Tyler, and projects that we were looking for are back on track. The big one being the I-20 and Highway 31 Mixmaster between Longview and Kilgore. It's a $350 million project. They'll be doing the engineering right now, and the environmental, that project is moving forward. If you've been going down Harrison Road, you can see that project on Harrison Road. The expansion of Harrison Road is coming along nicely. That was a partnership with the city and the county. We both put in, I think, about $1.4 million apiece to defray the cost in order for them to do that work. And the one I'm very proud of is the ones that will start probably this spring, will be the State Highway 42 from I-20 to Highway 80. And there's some other plans regarding Highway 42 that I can't talk about right now that aren't finalized, and they've enhanced that roadway even more. So we're excited about that. Connectivity continues to get better. We continue to look at where there's opportunities, where one county will turn down the money that TxDOT might want to spend. I'm going to have my hand raised real high. We've got some money that we'll be a part of. And I think that's been one of the bigger elements of our development. Connectivity to that. Talk a little bit about water. Water systems are an important concern of the county. And once I started studying the water systems of the county, we have a lot of work to do. Now, I'm not talking about the city of Longview, the city of Kilgore, and all the incorporated areas. I'm talking about the rural areas of Gregg County. Now, Gregg County is a small county. It's got a lot of land. And believe it or not, there's land out there that's not serviced by water. And if you don't have water, you can't have development. And that's one of the things we really focused on in this past year. Thanks to the leadership of court, we entered into some agreements with Liberty City to develop what I call a generational change in water in that part of the county. These water systems that were built were built 40, 50 years ago, and they haven't been improved since then. They've got 4-inch lines where they should have 8-inch lines. They have sewer systems that should have been replaced 10 years ago. Those are the things that we've gotten into to try and help and try and make this county ready for the next 50 years. And this is also a part of the county that does not have a lot of population, but it has a lot of land, but it doesn't have the full infrastructure it needs. And so part of the leadership of the court, we decided to change that. Assistance, as I said, was given to Liberty City Water. It was given to Liberty City Water Supply Corporation, the Liberty Danville Freshwater Supply District, and the West Gregg Special Utilities District. All these projects totaled a little over $6 million, about which the county paid half and they paid half. But without that participation, these projects would not have gotten done. We also assisted the city of Lakeport, the emergency wastewater project during Snowmageddon. The Snowmageddon came in under some of their infrastructure that's old and needs to be worked on, and they're a small community. They had a break in their sewer system and shut down the entire town. Gregg County came to their assistance, and we got that fixed and participated with a grant in order for that to be corrected. We'll talk a little bit about broadband access. As you well know, you've heard about broadband. Broadband is something that's, if you're inside of the cities, it's not too bad. If you get out in the rural areas of Gregg County, it's terrible. I live out in the rural area of Gregg County, and it's something that we need to work on. And these grant funds that we've received will allow us to do some of that. We're working right now with East Texas Council of Governments and Conterra Network. It's a local fiber-driven provider and network of communication services, which has set up all of the county's internet and broadband services. You know, sometimes dumb luck is pretty handy, and that's what we had about 10 years ago, where Conterra put in what they call a branch. It's like a branch. It sent out branches to every location inside the county to hook up our precinct barns, or we call precinct operations, and precinct 1, and precinct 3, and 4. Well, what that does, if you look at it on a map, what we want to do is complete that. It's called the blue line. The blue line will be a circle around that, and that's all out in the rural areas. And then once you build that circle around that, the broadband will be accessible to a lot more places than right now. We're working with that in conjunction with some of these water projects, because one of those water projects, we're going to be boring underneath I-20. And boring underneath I-20 is not a simple task. It involves the federal government, the state government, any other government you can come up with to get it done. And we're in the process of getting that done. But by doing that, by boring underneath I-20 from the Liberty City area, we're also going to be running broadband lines in that area. There's literally hundreds of acres that are underdeveloped because of the water and now the broadband that we'll have access to. And these are all going to take time, probably the next few years, but the contracts have been signed, the engineers have done their work, and most of these projects have already gone out for bid and should start fairly soon. Talk a little bit about mental health. Mental health, when you think about the county, you really don't think about mental health a lot, unless you're the county judge. You think about it every day. It plays a large role in the duties of the county judge's office, and our community is facing mental health issues as the state and the nation are. I can stand up here and give you all the reasons that I think it's caused, what's causing it. But you already probably know most of what I've said. We held, in my court 223 hearings regarding involuntary commitments to mental health facilities. Those are people that don't want to go, that we think need to go. We had 223 of those hearings. I signed 50 emergency detention warrants. And this is just what my office does. That didn't include what VH Jameson does in the JP's office. His numbers add to this. And he does quite a bit. So it is an issue that we continue to deal with. I might have talked to you 20 years ago, and I probably mentioned none of that. Because it hadn't got any better, and it's not gonna get any better. The state has been reluctant to commit money. They have this past legislation, they are building some new facilities finally. But it's very much of an issue. To put someone in a mental health hearing and go through the process to get them hospitalization and help, it takes about 6 or 7 people just to get them there. And when I say 6 or 7 people, I'm talking about it takes the county clerk, it takes the judge's office, it takes the sheriff's office, it takes sometimes the city of Long Beach PD, it takes community health court, state screening people. It takes a plethora of people to do one person. And so when you start taking those assets away during a period like this, COVID, it really becomes a challenge. I'm going to get into that in just a little bit. But because this county has such great collaboration with all the cities, and especially the city of Longview, the Community Health Corps, which is our local health authority, Christus Good Shepherd, Longview Regional, and the County Sheriff's Office, and Longview PD, have all joined forces to create what's called GLOW, Greater Longview Optimal Wellness. And this program is going to optimize our resources, streamline our mental health processes, and hopefully reduce the number of personnel dispatched to mental health agencies and get quicker service to those in need. As I said, one mental commitment touches numerous entities and personnel. Along mental health areas, let me talk a little bit about judicial. The judicial function at the Gregg County Courthouse is starting to ramp up to 100%. We've been slow to get there. We've been very cautious to get there. We've been very, very deliberate in talking with the Office of Court Administration as well as our surrounding neighbors in terms of what they're doing to make sure that we're not speeding things up and it's unsafe for the jurors and the people that are involved. But when you don't have court, you have people sitting in jail. People sitting in jail is not a place for them to be ever, because a lot of things happen when they're in jail. And we need to give them justice, and we need to move them either out of the jail or move them to their next step in life. So we've got a great, and I mean a great, set of district judges and county court of law judges that have been, I just can't say enough about those guys. They put in place protocols, and when they have jury selection, they ask the juries if they're selected, do you feel uncomfortable serving on this jury? And if you do because of COVID, you're released. And what is so great, going back to what I said earlier, nobody said that. They all want to serve. They all wear a mask if they feel uncomfortable, but they want to serve. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the people in this community. They're not fearful of doing their part in getting us back in normalcy that we hope to get back to someday. Because I don't need to tell you, COVID has changed all of our lives. And if you're in government, it has turned government upside down. And unfortunately, for governments much bigger than county, it's turned into political football. And I'm very, 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 very tired of that. I'm very tired of that. It's very clear we don't shut down, we've got to move forward, we can do it cautiously with protocols, and we can do it safely. And so I commend our judicial for where they are right now. We're over close to 400 cases behind in the judicial schedule because we shut down for almost a year of judicial. We want to get back. We want to get back to where we are. And so we're getting there. And I'm very proud of the judicial the departments, specifically our county judges, district judges, because they are in county court law judges, because they are, have done a yeoman's job of getting that all done. Let's talk a little bit about downtown. Over 4,000 people come to the courthouse when we're fully 100% a week. 4,000 people a week come to do business, in and out. Some stay there for the trial and other things. What's the biggest frustration you think when people come to the courthouse? When you come downtown, what's your biggest frustration? Since we weren't here, wasn't it? As my speech said, that you just said, if I were to ask the single biggest frustration while visiting or working downtown, what would you say? Parking. And that's it. It's challenging to be parked downtown near the courthouse, post office areas, whether you are a reporter for jury duty, needing to register your vehicle, obtaining a passport, birth certificate, or just visiting local businesses or restaurants. It's imperative to our businesses and our residents to be able to easily access downtown. The last time we spoke, I showed you the early plan of the parking facility. And one of the really problems that we don't talk about is the lack of parking downtown is people park in front of other businesses downtown to come to the courthouse. Well, then those people that have businesses downtown go, hey, you're taking up all my parking. And so this is a trickle-down effect of that not having parking. It's just, it's a very much of a trickle-down effect. As you all know, I think it was 2.5 years ago, the time gets by, or 3 years ago, we bought the land across from Regions Bank. Well, I'm glad to announce today we'll be taking our Parking Facility Committee's recommendation to court on the January 27th court meeting to move forward on that project. If the Commission, of course, elect to proceed on our downtown, we'll have an additional 450 parking spaces, and the additional parking will help alleviate traffic congestion, remedy parking problems, and if all goes well, the Commission's court bid process for the Parking Facility can begin as soon as this year. So, I'm very proud of that. Well, it's taken us a long time to get there. As Commissioner McKinney would tell me all the time, you're kicking that can down the road. Let's get it done. Commissioner, you agree with that?
I agree.
So, thanks to Commissioner McKinney's leadership and others, we're going to move forward on that project, and hopefully we'll have something to report next time I'm giving you the state of the county. A little quick on East Texas Regional Airport. We've expanded public parking down the areas of East Texas Regional Airport, assisted by Precinct 4. If you have not been at the airport, you ought to go. There's numerous large hangars that have been developed out there. We continue to increase our private jet fleet out there by numerous private businesses. A lot of heavy irons are being flown out of Gregg County Airport. A lot of heavy irons being moved, and I say heavy iron, I'm talking about big jets. He's being moved into Gregg County from other parts of our counties around us because of our tax rate. They're basing their planes here. And we're having to, the new hangars being developed are being developed so they have a place to put the planes. It's all being done by private developers. We extended the Southwest Aviation Road by a quarter of a mile. That's the inside road inside the fenced area of the airport for security. Security at airports is becoming more and more and more detailed and more required to do certain things for people to be on the airport, certain areas of the airport. And so we're glad to get that done. Over the next 2 years, both major runways will be overlaid at an approximate cost of $3 million. The FAA will pay for 80% of it, and the county's piece will be 20%. The new construction expansion, these are all basically were done inside the city of Longview, but the county was involved in the negotiations of the tax abatements, and that's Aon expansion, Old Lady Gap Distribution Center. And if you haven't been out there, you really don't need to see how big a building is. It's huge. It's absolutely huge. And they're talking about building another one, which I hope they do. At Camfield and Kilgore, a new company just announced a move to Kilgore. It's an air filtration manufacturing company. I know about it. I'm sorry. And these were all incentivized with county tax abatements, working closely with LEADCO and KITCO. And Avigen North America High Tech Genetics Lab that incubates hatches and breeds chicks that are shipped all over the world, with the city being lead on that. LEADCO will open in 2023 and create about 70 jobs. enhanced services or ongoing projects right now. One of the things we've done this past year with some of these grant funds is we put $2.8 million in the Sheriff's Department to digitize all of our communication. It hasn't been done in close to 20 years. This will allow the Sheriff's Department to talk just about any law enforcement agency, federal and or state, in this region on any one given time. We will continue to work with our broadband services, as I mentioned. We renovated the Elderville Community Center located in Precinct 4. I did see Mark Abernathy, and I don't think I've ever mentioned this, which I'm kind of proud about, but we did a couple of years ago, was we put a community tax office in downtown Gladewater, the city of Gladewater. We closed that other building over there. I heard from Gladewater citizens about the tax office, and we settled in and put one side of the city. So thank you, Mark, for your help.
Thank you.
Assisted the city of Longview with the Arboretum projects. Obviously, you know, the Blue Racing moving in downtown from the airport, and the commissioner and all the precincts with equipment 1, 3, and 4 helped start creating a new area for balloons to land and to take off from. We'll plan on renovation of the county clerk's office in the near future. The renovations of my courtroom and my office is just about done. If you've been up at the courthouse, you'll see that we're my private office is a bench outside the hallway. That's where I have my private meetings, in the hallway. And we're really ready to get that done. We participate with the city of Longview's newly stated certified arts district. It's leased the community, that we just leased the Longview Community Center to the Arts Longview as part of the collaboration. And let me tell you, that's really a diamond. It's really a diamond. The two together is going to really, in my opinion, going to provide a venue that we haven't seen here in 25 years. I remember when I was very young, when I had black hair, that I would go into that community center and watch plays and listen to speakers, and it all just went away. But I think with the leadership of Arts Longview, because I've heard their plans, I know what they want to do, this is the reason we decided to do the dream that we did with them, is because this is going to create a really diamond in the city of Longview for small venues, for small plays, for speakers. It's just a great building that we felt like it was important for us to keep. I was encouraged by a number of citizens to keep it. And so I did. That's it. I'm on board, I'm on the team. What came about from that is we had 12 county buildings that were built back in the 50s, 60s. They're old, decrepit. Some of them have torn down. Some of them we've given to the cities that they were in, so the cities could take it over and they could enlarge it. And so we're down to 5 buildings down the county operates outside. We're not in the business to provide that. That should be somebody else. That should be Arts Longview or other folks. The city of Longview does a great job. In the venues they have for that, and in those 12 to 5, getting rid of those was that 7 buildings, the savings of what we were having to pay to keep those things alive was not necessary. All right, I'm going to talk a little bit quickly about finance. Our reserves, our unrestricted reserves are right at about $55 million, give or take. That's down somewhat during COVID. We had a dip in reserves because sales tax was down, a lot of things were down, courts weren't down, fees weren't coming in, and it was no problem because we've got a strong financial position. Our group health and dental insurance costs are at 19%. To help offset that cost, we have changed the employees' copay and their deductibles, which will contribute close to $300,000 back to the county and increase, and without losing many of the benefits that they enjoy right now, but it will save the county over $300,000. Due to the staff shortage at the sheriff's office, overtime expenses increased 17%. We're 45 people short in the jail. Nobody wants to come work in the jail. If you've ever been in the jail, you understand why. Anybody want to admit they've been in the jail? I walk through that jail every month, and it's not a job. It's a tough tough job. And so one of the things we did this past budget year is we increased the pay to the jailers now. So with the jailers' beginning salaries and their insurance and retirement, it's close to a $50,000 job now. For I think right 40,000, and of course the insurance and the retirement. So we're trying to address that problem, but it's a tough one. We got as high as 21 staff shortages because of COVID. And that's patrol, that's the staff, fortunately all of them come back. We spent a lot of men and women spend a lot of overtime to make sure the streets stay safe in the county. But it certainly increased our cost 70%. Over the last 2 years, liability insurance premiums have increased over 40% from $519,000 to $784,000, and that's FY22. So for licensing, increased 35% over the last 2 years from $745,000, a little over $1 million. Fuel expenses increased 21% from FY20 to FY21, and we anticipate another 23% in FY22, which results in budgeting $483,000 to cover the rise in cost. Inmate cost fluctuation, depending on jail population, inmates, those costs really go down. And the grocery budget just for the jail is a little over $1 million. And the indigent medical budget is up 11% at FY22 at $905,000. You can see we've got challenges in financial, but no different than what everybody in this room is probably experiencing. In terms of seeing increased costs, just about everything you do and everything you buy. We just got finished with redistricting. We completed that with precincts. So we moved about 2,700 of the population out of precinct 1 to precinct 4 to equal the population, which is precinct now has about 31,000 population in each precinct. We continue to, and I'll just throw this out, we continue to look at different initiatives we might be able to do for COVID. Not ready to really announce those yet, but we continue to have our eyes on COVID. We've got one person that does nothing but come up with ideas and talking to his counterparts about how we can do things better to react to that. In closing, I believe that in tough times, you become more of what you are at the core. The county's business slogan has always been achieving excellence together, and I think Gregg County achieved that excellence this past year. At the end of the day, every year, my hope is that Gregg County will be better than it was the year before. And doing what is right for Gregg County is always the right thing to do. I'm done. We'll pass the time that we want to answer the questions. I'll be here if y'all want to go and answer the questions. Anybody have any? Yes, sir. Well, the patrol is.
But not the jail.
No, and we still hold, we have all these patrol, but not to the city as well, because we don't have as many officers as the city does. But it's a problem. It really is a problem. We gave 5,000 warnings to all the sheriff's employees, and then looked at command staff and the officer on the street and some changes. So we got our pay a little bit closer to City of Longview, but it's not as what City of Longview pays, and it's just we can't get there. And we got to take a little bit of time. Yes, sir.
Why is Longview Regional not taking that $1 million?
Well, that's a question you'll have to ask them. They certainly have been notified of it. We've talked a number of times to Steve Gordon, who's the CEO, and they're trying to work with corporate on some different ideas, and hopefully they'll come to a conclusion soon. But I can't give you the exact reason. Good question. Thank you all very much. It's an honor to be a county chair. Saved on the bottom line in terms of what I look at, the bottom line in terms of having to utilize where they start shutting down. If it gets closer to 6 and then it gets down to a low point and it starts cranking back up at 3 in the morning, by the time everybody's there, it's all good. It's probably going to save us between $300,000 and $350,000. out of the year.